ओम साई राम। हियर वी आर बैक विद द नेक्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ योर चैप्टर 5, चेंजेस एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ विलेजेस एंड अर्बनाइजेशन इन इंडिया। सो इन टुडेज पार्ट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द कमिटीज दैट वर सेट अप टू स्टडी द अग्रेरियन इश्यूज इन कर्नाटका। बेसिकली कमिटीज वर देयर टू study the issues that led to farmers commit the suicide. So in the last part we studied the large number of farmer suicide being reported from all over India. So we studied particularly the case of Karnataka, and in this particular part we are going to see how the government took up some measures to work towards the welfare of farmers, especially the poor farmer, which was earlier a neglected section. So we'll see how these committees have worked for upliftment of the farmer status and addressing the issues that the farmers faced, which led to their suicide. So, but before we go on, let's discuss the answers to the questions we asked you the last time. Discuss the methodological analysis of farmer suicides in India. So you have to discuss events, stressors, triggers, actors, those 4 points. Then look at the flowchart at page 130 of your book and discuss the link between methods of organization of agricultural activity and an increased risk leading to the stress and indebtedness resulting in suicide. So if you look at the page 130 of your book, you'll see that flowchart there. Although it is not directly related to all the issues that are described in your chapter, still it is fine to understand the flowchart and also to be ready to answer some questions based on that. So here these were two main headings: methods of organization of agricultural activity. That is how agricultural activity was organized for the farmer and how this organization led to the increased risk leading to stress and indebtedness. So what were the faulty factors that were there in the organization of agricultural activity that led to stress, increasing the stress and indebtedness, which ultimately resulted in suicide? Basically that you have to understand. What the question is asked, you know, what is being asked. So under these two headings, there were 6 points that was discussed, that the farmers had become increasingly dependent on certain things that led to the increase in their stress, that led to the increase in their indebtedness, and ultimately it resulted in suicide. So what were these dependencies on? Increased dependency, it was on non-food crop that they had to grow. They were bound to grow the cash crops that could give them some money to sustain their life. That was one of the stressors for them. Increased dependency on groundwater for irrigation, because there were no other facilities were there for them to irrigate their crop. So they were dependent completely on groundwater. And what was happening with the groundwater? Groundwater was increasingly getting depleted. It was getting over very fast. So in that case, what was happening? It was again increasing the insecurity and anxiety and problems, stress to the farmer. On informal credit, that is, you have already read that it was very difficult for the Indian, poor Indian farmer to approach the commercialized or state banks for any kind of loan facility because of the tedious process that was involved there. And these farmers did not have that much of time or skill or education to understand the process and procure the loan for themselves. So they had to depend on the private money lenders. And these money lenders would do a lot of exploitation, and they will charge an exorbitant amount of interest from these farmers, which was again a factor leading to the stress and indebtedness. Indebtedness meaning they were not able to return or repay the loan that they once had taken from these private money lenders. And this again was one of the reasons for them to come under stress. Then increased dependency on market inputs. Market for inputs. So this was the open market, and the prices of the inputs may go very high. Inputs are the agricultural inputs, machinery, labor, all those things which are required to carry on the agricultural activity. So if the labor becomes expensive or the machinery becomes expensive, again it will lead to a lot of stress to this poor farmer, which ultimately resulted in their suicide. Volatile output markets, that is the output markets, that means the produce that they have produced, that will also have very fluctuating prices in the market. So they may earn some profit sometimes, or they may not earn any profit sometimes, or they may just face losses. So all that again increased their risk and increased the stress. Then there was increased dependency on human development and life cycle events. So now, human development would mean education, looking after the family, health, food, all those things which are required to sustain a life. That was progressively getting very difficult for these poor farmers. And other life cycle events, birth in the family, marriage in the family, death in the family, they will have big, enormous ceremonies for such events, and which was a kind of a public obligation. They had to do it, but they had no money to support these kind of events. So this again led to their stress, which resulted in their suicide. So I hope you have understood these basic points and have understood what was the condition and plight of those farmers who committed suicide. Now we are going to discuss in this part the committees that were set up by the government of Karnataka to understand what were the agrarian issues, that is the issues related to the agricultural activities of the farmers and the related areas. What are the problems the farmers were facing? So these committees were set up as a response to the farmers' suicide. First one was Dwarkanath Committee, set up in 2000 under the chairmanship of Mr. Dwarkanath, who was the agricultural scientist. And he made studies on testing BT cotton in Karnataka. So BT cotton was a genetically modified organism. GMO, it is called GMO, and it really developed one pest resistant plant quality of cotton, which produces an insecticide to combat any kind of pest infestation on the crops, just to save the crop from any kind of damage by the pests. So this particular variety of organism will help combat those kind of pests, so the crop can be saved. Then there was agricultural biotechnology. What is biotechnology? It is a technology which basically utilizes the biological systems, that is living organism systems, to develop and create different procedures or increase the productivity of your agricultural exercise. The example for biotechnology can be of bakery. You must have seen baking of bread, and there is one particular ingredient that is used to bake the bread to ferment the solid mixture, which is called yeast, Y-E-A-S-T, yeast. So that yeast is a living organism which helps to expedite the process of fermentation and increase in the productivity. So all these things were introduced. These are the new technologies that were introduced to the farmer of Karnataka. role of hybrid rice. Hybrid rice was also a kind of a rice which was had a parent from genetically modified rice seeds, and which actually led to higher production or higher yield. So all these would increase the productivity of the crop. So it was very helpful for the farmer, and it is like bringing a new technology to help the farmer. And this commission supported field trials of BT cotton and thereby supported biotechnology in Karnataka. So biotechnology was supported in Karnataka, which was very good for the farmers. Next came G.K. Veeresh committee's report. This was the third big reason. Fourth reason was family problems, which were the personal problems being faced by the farmer. Then next one was chronic illness, that is long time illness by the farmer. So the farmer committed suicide. So this comes, and not only this state but all over India. But these were the reasons given by this committee: marriage of daughters, political affiliations, property disputes, debt burden, price crash, borrowing beyond paying capacity, and house construction, loss of agricultural activities, and failure of bore wells. So these reasons were cited for the farmer's suicide by this committee. So the government took some very strong steps to uplift the condition of the farmer. And here we are going to take only the state of Karnataka. So at the wake of farmer suicide, what particular initiatives that were taken to mitigate the condition or to better the condition of the farmer? The first one was loan waivers and relief. In 2008, Government of Karnataka waived the principal amount of outstanding loan on all farmers up to rupees 25,000. So any farmer who has taken loan of rupees 25,000 is no longer supposed to pay it back. It is all completely cleared for them. This was one very big relief for the farmer. Next one was their interest was waived off who had borrowed more than 25,000 rupees. So 25,000, they had to, more than 25,000 if they have borrowed, they had to return the principal amount, yes. But the interest rate on that principal amount will be now waived off. They don't have to pay it. This was also a very big relief for the farmer, but they had to pay the principal amount before a particular date. Next step that was taken by the government was Exorbitant Interest Rate Act that was introduced in 2004. And here the government of Karnataka. So this particular act, it put a complete stop on exploitative practices by the private money lender who were trying to extract as much money possible from the poor farmer in the name of interest. So the government of Karnataka put a stop on, or a ceiling on, how much money they could ask for in the name of interest. They could not, the private money lenders could not move beyond that particular amount of money for the interest. If they charged more than that amount for the interest, there were punishments for them, and it would attract imprisonment of 3 years and a fine of 30,000 or both. So this would help the farmer to save themselves from the exploitation of this private money lenders, as now a ceiling or the interest rate has been fixed by the government, and the private money lender also cannot go beyond that fixed rate of interest set up by the government. Third step of relief that was offered to the farmer was basically to respond to the farmer's distress by appointing a particular committee under the chairmanship of G.K. Veeresh. And this committee came out with a series of recommendations, such as creation of farmers' welfare fund. That means you have to create a welfare fund for the farmer. So in case of any financial loss or any financial support if needed, they can turn to this kind of a welfare fund. They can get the money from this welfare fund. And then establishment of modal department for the welfare of farmers. So one particular department was set up in the village for the welfare of farmers, where farmers could go and address their issues to these welfare forums or departments, and these departments will take quick action on the farmers' problems. Then there were social security measures. These social securities are basically the kind of insurances that were offered to the farmers. Following this, the government of Karnataka took a series of steps to mitigate farmers' distress. So basically, this Viresh committee report gave you these three recommendations: that you please create farmers' welfare fund and create a department for welfare of farmers and create some kind of social security measure for the farmer. So based on these three points, the Karnataka government undertook various steps, a series of steps to mitigate farmers' distress. What were those steps? Health insurance scheme. First thing was that their health was insured. That in case of, because health is one area where a lot of money is spent, and in the family, every other day, any other person, can fall sick, and then one has to look after their health needs, which can be very expensive if one goes to private hospitals or undertake private treatments. Just to address that issue, health insurance schemes were introduced, where the farmers can now are under the coverage of insurance. We'll study about them in greater detail. Let's first see what are these schemes. The interest rate on loans from cooperative banks. So now the cooperative banks will set up the loans or the final amount that can be charged as an interest on the loans given to the farmers. Then review of the compensation policy. That is, the dead farmer's family, what kind of compensation is given to them, whether it has reached the family or not, all that. Next one was information facility, Raita Sampark Kendras. Then crop insurance, then scheme on seed subsidy, watershed development program, the market intervention scheme, and the priority to agricultural research. So these are the series of steps that were taken by the government of Karnataka to ease out the problems of the farmers, so that those kind of incidents of farmers committing suicide never take place again. Let's take them up now one by one. First one is health insurance scheme. So then very good health insurance scheme was introduced with the name of Yashaswini Health Scheme for Farmers in 2000. So it helped them to have direct access to the best medical facilities available in the state-run hospitals. So they can undergo the treatment in the state hospitals on reduced expenditure on the health. So this will help the farmer reduce the expenditure on health. And what did it take? Just a very, very nominal premium payment of rupees 120 for the entire year per family. It is like charging nothing from the family. So the participants are covered for all surgical interventions, that is all operations and major surgeries. But some of the surgeries were excluded from this. And some, there is a particular list which was given to them, which says what kind of surgeries will be undertaken under the scheme. So not very major surgeries, but minor surgeries maybe. And for the outpatient services at any designated network hospitals. So any outpatient services, that means the patients can come and go that day itself. So there was a network of hospitals was established. Or the networking was established with various hospitals under this Yashaswini Health Scheme for Farmers. Second point was the interest rate on loans from cooperative banks. It was reduced from 6% per annum, which was there in 2007-08, to 4% per annum in 2007-08. This significantly helped the farmers. Review of the compensation policy. So the existing policy of compensation to the family of victims who is the victim, the farmers who had committed suicide. It was thoroughly reviewed and compensation was allowed only in the case where suicide was directly related to farming activities. Only when the farmer has committed suicide due to failure of crop or failure of his agricultural activity, only in that case these kind of money or this kind of compensation will be provided to the farmer's family, which will come about with a great depth of investigation. Otherwise, for any personal reasons that we had discussed in the Veeresh committee report, for example gambling, alcoholism or spendthriftness, all such issues, this kind of compensation will not be issued to these families. Then information facility, which is called Raita Sampark Kendras. So what are these Raita Sampark Kendras? These were the basic unit of agriculture by the agricultural department scheme, which envisages for training farmers and farm women in agricultural and allied activities. So basically to provide training to the farmer in the farming as well as allied activities also. Also, they were provided internet access and telephone facilities so that these farmers can initiate any signals of distress, which will directly transmit it to the state headquarters so that a quick and immediate action can be taken for the farmer's issue. Also, in the extension wing of the Department of Agriculture, telephone links were established to reach the concerned officials with ease. So in the Department of Agriculture, there were various telephone links. In case of any problem, any farmer can link with the officers and they will help the farmer with their issues. Next point is, fifth point, E point, is crop insurance. So you must be remembering that their crop loss was one of the major reasons why these farmers committed suicide. So now the crop is insured. So even if there is a loss, they will be paid some compensation so that their money is not lost. It will be taken up in Hubli level and compensation will be provided to the farmers based on the Hubli level data. What is this Hubli level? Hubli level is where a cluster of villages are taken together for administrative purposes, be it tax collection, be it any kind of administrative policy to be implemented. This is called a cluster of villages are taken together. That is called Hubli level. So the crops were insured at the Hubli level, at that level where the cluster of village can be taken as the beneficiary of this crop insurance. Next, sixth point is scheme of seed subsidy. That is, the farmers will be given seeds at a very low price. At the subsidy, meaning it will be at a subsidized rate, that is reduced rate. So they will be given the seeds. Seeds will be sold to the poor farmer with a subsidy up to 50%, half the price, half the market price. Very, very important point is watershed development programs, because irrigation always failed the farmers' crops and they had to increasingly get dependent on the groundwater, and the groundwater was also fast depleting. So this was a major cause for their helplessness. To address this issue, these kind of watershed development programs were initiated by the government. What are these watershed development programs? These developmental programs by the government of India, they aim to restore the ecological balance by harnessing, conserving and developing degraded natural resources such as soil, vegetative cover and water. So you know, with repeated farming, the soil loses its capacity to bear crop again. So what to do? These watershed development programs will restore the nutritive layer of the soil and will make the soil rich again. And the same soil can give you a lot of yield. So this was one major step taken by the government. Also, it helped in prevention of soil erosion. What is soil erosion? You know that with a lot of floods, the soil, the upper layer of the soil, or with storms, the upper layer of the soil, which is the most nutritive layer of the soil, it gets eroded, it gets moved from there, and then with that movement or with that erosion, the soil loses its capacity of being nutrient. So it cannot bear fruits as it was bearing before. Regeneration of natural vegetation. So once the soil is given back its nutritive quality, the regeneration of natural vegetation can be restored. Rainwater harvesting was introduced under this scheme, that whenever the rain comes, it should not end up in flooding the area. The same rainwater can be utilized to use at the time of need, that is at the time when there are no rains. The same rainwater is stored somewhere. That is called rainwater harvesting, and that water can be reused for irrigation and recharging of the groundwater table. So groundwater will also be recharged, which was fast depleting. So this was a very important step taken by the government, and the investment on watershed development programs increased tenfold, and that created increased employment opportunities also in the rain-fed areas. Then the market intervention scheme. The market intervention scheme, MIS, was implemented by the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation, which is Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So an entire ministry was set up for agriculture and farmers welfare now. The objective of this market intervention scheme is to provide remunerative prices to the farmers, that is good prices to the farmer, which will be like a price to the farmer. And in case of excess production and fall in prices. So whenever there is a fall, you remember that there was the market is very volatile. Volatile meaning the price keep fluctuating, the price of the crops keep fluctuating up and down, up and down. So sometimes the farmers may just regain what all they had lost in the agricultural activity, or sometimes they may just lose because the prices have come very low. But with this scheme, market intervention scheme, they will be paid by the government some good prices so that they can recover any losses or they can withstand the fluctuations in the market. Next point is priority to agricultural research. So there was agricultural research is now being given a lot of importance because the government has realized that the India lives in the villages, and agriculture is the main occupation of Indian people, and it is rather the backbone of Indian economy, the agriculture. So the agriculture, the research in this field is very much solicited. The government really appreciates the research in agriculture field, and the focus is now more on demand. That is, what kind of agriculture produce are being demanded by the people. So those should also only be produced more and more. So this is the big shift in this research. Earlier it was on supply driven research priorities, that what all is being produced, where is it going, who all are buying. It was based on supply that we have now created, we have now planted these, these plants are there, and these producer is there, and we are going to sell whatever is available to us. That is called supply driven research. But now it has become just the opposite, where there is a lot of input is being going in the areas of on what kind of crop or agricultural produce is in demand. Now came the agricultural policy. So the philosophy of the present agricultural policy lies in the concept of Panch Sutra, very important concept. It was announced by the state in its budget 2006 and 2007 for the accelerated growth in agriculture. So Panch Sutra, meaning five formulae or five components of the sutra, are: first, to protect and improve soil health. As we have already discussed, if the soil loses its nutritive value, it is of no use, it becomes barren, and it can have no produce on it. So the first and foremost thing for the state government was to protect and improve, not only protect, also improve the health of the soil so that it can give rise to a healthy production. Then conservation of natural resources with special emphasis on water and micro irrigation. So water needs to be conserved because water is the only source which is going to sustain the crop in the form of irrigation. So that needs to be conserved. And micro irrigation, that means small level irrigation, will also be looked after. Timely availability of credit and other inputs to the farmer. So whenever the farmer requires credit or other inputs for the farmer activity, it should be given then and there. It should not be delayed, because everything depends on the farmer's produce. If the farmer is not able to produce anything, it will again go into loss, and again the same cycle will begin, leading to such drastic results such as suicide. So it has to be timely. The inputs and credit has to be very timely given to the farmer. Next point, fourth point, integration of post-harvest processing with the production process. So what is the post-harvest processing? First, there is a harvest that you have cut your crop. Then again, there is an entire cycle of taking the grain out. Helping the farmer with the entire process after harvest is also one of the major steps taken by the government under this Panch Sutra. Then reducing the distance between lab to land in transfer of technology. So this is very, very important. There were some scientific innovations, technological innovation that take place to help the farmer, but they never reach the farmer. So this reduces the distance between these innovations or experimentations to reach the farmer. It should reach the farmer very fast. So agricultural census was conducted in all the states and union territories in the countries at the insistence of Ministry of Agriculture and Cooperation, Government of India. It is a quinquennial census, that is 5 yearly, conducted once in 5 years since its inception in 1970-71. So this kind of census, agricultural census will be taken by the government every 5 years, and it has been there since 1970 and 71. So far 9 agricultural censuses have been conducted, and the latest being in 2010 and 11 census. Now there are further solutions to retrieve agricultural crisis. So other than what all has been discussed with you, there are more solutions to address the agricultural crisis. There should be a growth in farm incomes. So the growth in farm incomes to be revived and rejuvenated. Public investments, infrastructure, institutions and development of new technology to be increased manifold. Social reforms in villages should take place. It is necessary in the rural areas to reduce drug abuse, alcoholism, gambling, okay, all those points, and to cut down unnecessary expenditure on festivities, marriages, feasts and other uneconomic activities. So all these activities drain the money away from the farmer. So these need to be curtailed. These kind of activities which take all the money of the farmer, all the savings of the farmer, should be curtailed. So this kind of a movement was necessary in the rural areas. Also the drug abuse should be reduced. Then there are community-driven development programs. This broadly implies reversing control and accountability from central authorities to community organizations to initiate planning, implementation, operation, maintenance and evaluation of developmental projects, with agencies playing only a supportive role. So this community-driven development, what basically it does, it controls and accountability from central authorities to community organizations. So the community people will look after themselves instead of the central authorities, the bureaucrats coming and looking after them, which was introduced by the British government, was still carried over by the Indian government. It was now stopped, not actually stopped, but the authority and the concern was shared by now the community developers. Those who were living in the community, those who lived the problems of the community, those who knew the problems of the community, they will be taking proper developmental projects for the community. Any planning, any implementation and operation, maintenance and evaluation of any kind of developmental projects, these agencies will be playing a main role. Which agencies? The community agency. The community people will be playing the main role. People from the village itself will be taking care of the development of the village with the support of the central government. Yes, the government is there to support them. But the government will not go and run their own programs there because they may not be very suitable for the problems that these people are facing. Then this community-driven development programs involved information dissemination, consultation, collaboration to support empowerment. So this creates a kind of awareness in the people also. These kind of community awareness programs are also being run by these authorities or community organizers. What kind of awareness? For example, the issues related to alcoholism, issues related to gambling, issues related to spending too much money in the marriages and birth ceremonies, death ceremonies. So these kind of awareness are also being spread through these community development programs, which are done by the community members only with the support of the central government or the government. Then community-driven development is most appropriately used for the provision of local goods, basic services and management of natural resources. So management of natural resources would include the soil, the water, the air, the plants, the vegetation. How will they be managed so that they are not completely eroded, they are not completely vanished? So they should be taken good care so that there is a good harmony between people and their natural environment. Then the participation in community driven development involves information dissemination, consultation and collaboration to support empowerment and control of community groups over decisions and resources. So basically all the participation of community workers will help in information dissemination, that is information will be reached, will be sent to each nook and corner of these communities. Consultation and collaboration, so they can consult with each other and can collaborate with each other. They can come together as a team. For what? To support empowerment. Empowerment of whom? Empowerment of the farmer. That is giving him power. How can you get power? You can get power only through knowledge. That you are aware the problems in your field and you are aware how to solve these problems. When you know these two things, you can be called as empowered. You know the problem and you know the solution and you can implement the solution also. So that is called, that is what they mean by empowerment. Or the control of community groups over decisions and resources. So the community groups only will have control over resources and they only will take decisions regarding the community developmental programs. So this was the end of this part, where we discussed the various measures taken by the state government to help the farmers improve their financial condition, personal condition and agricultural issues so that they can get a better life and can sustain their agricultural practices. So here are the questions for you to answer. Explain the two committees appointed by the government of Karnataka to study the agrarian crisis. then explain the agricultural Panch Sutras. And third question is, write the recent policy initiative to mitigate farmer suicide in Karnataka. So answer these three questions and send the assignments. Check your assignments with the answers that we'll give you in the next part of the same chapter. So until then, take good care of yourself. Om Sai Ram.